This is the plane of reflection. Okay. Can you tell me which is the direction of the
light?
Like this, right? So this is the angle of reflection. And so the normal. Can you tell me then what would be the direction of the incidence? If you know the angle of reflection, normal, and what would be the direction of the angle of incidence? Do you know law of reflection? The angle of incidence should be equal to angle of reflection. It can be reflected. Suppose this angle I am being fixed. It can be like this, so that this angle is fixed. But this side is enough. Will it be like this? If it is like this, it is not coming up. You should understand. It should be such that it should come up. But there is one thing more. That is the plane. That is a restriction. That is the angle of reflection. The normal and the angle of incidence makes a plane. Now see, if you rotate into this, now all of these are same plane. Right. So angle of incidence is equal to angle of reflection. Angle of reflection is equal to angle. And this is the normal. And the light is coming from this direction. So that is what we are demonstrating. If you know the angle of reflection as well as the plane of incidence,
When you have one so one line vertical angle, so then you don't see the light coming. So similarly here we arrange that there are two polarizers which are orthogonal to each other. So now if you shine the
fish,
you see that
fish and some
jellyfish.
What
you see is very less.
Something which is here.
So now you can introduce a medium which is a sugar solution.
If you see it, you see that equation. Okay. So, I can tell you.
You see, its intensity has increased, same intensity. So what happens is that this medium has actually rotated the axis of polarization.
If I close this.
So basically, just like this initially, now because of this,
it started to go like this. Okay.
And because this is only
you
have that
this is the reflected reaction because we are not bending like this.
Yes. Actually, वो क्या करते हैं सब उसको घुमाते हैं
So it kind of blocks the light. But if I have something which is in between, which is made diagonal, what happens? So two objects do not allow the light, right? So third object which is oriented diagonal, will that allow the light to go through or not? If I just place it in between, light will go through. Why? So now here, this is going through this and this. Light doesn't go through. But if I put it, you see some light goes through. So why does this happen?
I just want to tell you one thing. So I talked to you.
Okay, because of the property of collision of light, which is the
6th. There is only one spot where you can hold it stable. But as soon as you get displaced from that position, so you can map this problem to here and over. Like this position is equilibrium, but as soon as you go in any direction, you will fall down. Like here. This falling down.
But it is in the
center, it is going up and down. But slight perturbation or slight disturbance, but if it is going in that direction, like move like this, it will not go out of that. So we can use this structure. Actually, this is analogous to that. So we can use electric or magnetic field to create something like this. Or actually it creates like this. This is analogous to this. And if we try to move it, like if we try to fall in like this, and if we move my center like this, then it will try to trap. So if we rotate at a particular frequency, so let's see. It is not centrifugal. It is just this potential is moving and this thing is coming here. So if particle you have gone here and this thing comes here, then it will apply force in that direction. Because in this direction it is the force which is always directed towards center, but in direction in this direction it is not the force. It will just go out. So we will see and try to check if we rotate this. Can it hold for some time? How long? So according to us, it should hold for some time. Okay.
So only if you make it something opposite to it.
No, speed in. Actually, this is not ideal. It should be like so in which class you are? Okay, so in high standard, maybe you will. Have you seen spring? If you pull spring, then it goes like again in hold at one end. So this thing is analogous to that. If particle goes away from the center in this direction, it will always try to come. Similar kind of a string, huh? String kind of a ball.
Okay. So what is in a turbine happens, the water falls, the turbine water and a magnet, and it produces a current in the coil. So that current is given to our house. Similar principle happens. Here you can see you have magnetic field lines. Like when you put a bar magnet, which has north and south, there are magnetic field lines around it. Current that is producing in this coils. Now this will produce a magnetic field which opposes this motion. Right? When it goes down, it will create a magnetic field inside this coil that will try to push it up. Upside. So you have a force down, which is your gravity, but the current producing the coil is pushing it. Yes. So then it slows down. So you have a force down and it goes up because of this it slows. Now this law is the Lenz law. Set. Okay. So the magnetic field opposes the magnet's motion inside a conductor. It will take even longer.
So, if you tell this out, you are giving some initial momentum. When I release it, it will have some velocity. That momentum should be preserved because I am not giving any external force here, I am just living it. Okay? So center of mass should be fixed and this momentum should be transferred to the last ball. It will move the same height from where I am raising it. And also the energy will be transferred. Okay? So this happened, right? Same height, same velocity, it will acquire. Now what's happened? I can choose two balls. What do you expect?
More momentum, so more height.
More height or?
Two balls.
Because the center mass should be fixed. So it happens there. Now what happens if I use three balls? Anyone? There are only five, right?
Because the last three.
One will go.
Last three.
That is only last two.
Yeah. So even this will join them and go.
Okay. See.
Yeah.
It's joining.
So it will be like three goes and again three goes. So center of mass should be always fixed. Whatever you do, that's the principle of linear momentum conservation. Now where?
The working of Tesla coil, but rather what it does is if we supply energy to that, what happens is some charge will be deposited. Do you know what charge is? Electric charge? Have you heard about that? So there is atom, right? So in atom there are constituents like electrons and nucleus. Okay, this electron has a property called charge. That's what I am referring to. Huh? So in this Tesla coil, if I give it some battery power, what it does is it accumulates some charge on top of this. Okay, here now there is a charge. Now I am powering this on. Now charge will be here. Now how I will see this? This is a bulb. You have seen this, right? Okay, so what is inside is xenon gas filled inside. And this white color what you see is phosphorus. Huh? So if I bring it close together, it will blow. How it's blowing? What happens is, inside there is this atom and electrons. And there is a charge here. And this charge is attracting the electrons inside. And it comes towards this. And on the way,
it's positive.
It's negative. Whether it's positive or negative, it doesn't matter. If it's negative, it will just ripple. Okay, then it goes away. So whatever it is, it strikes the phosphorus in between. And when electron strikes the phosphorus, it glows. That's what you are seeing here. Okay. It's called induction. Induction. Conduction means with contact, induction means without
contact. There was some couple of chapters about because I have bought about
Reaction. What happens is this guy has got reactivity of two different. What happened first when as soon as you add, this reaction is very fast reaction. So immediately HIO generation will take. Once HIO takes place, what happens? HIO will react with I minus in the solution to form I2. That time will get an amber color, which is the color of iodine. So once the iodine starts accumulating in the solution, what happens? Then iodine will start reacting its own reaction with carbonic acid and I minus. This I minus can be detected when you have a starch. So presence of starch. So now what happens? All the I2s getting converted to I minus, nothing is got bulk. Once all the I2s has been reacted, what happens? Again, this I2 generation reaction takes place. So this reaction will keep oscillating between both. Still, what happens? Either HIO has to be completely consumed or melanic acid has to be completely. Here we added equal more, that's why when you stop the reaction, it gets worse. Otherwise, if you take any more, what happens? Depending on whichever is higher. Whether you take this is higher. In that case, your amber color or basis. If you take this as higher, you will get your
purple color.
No. This is just one example of there are some 4 to 5 other examples. This is like whatever the chemicals available are cheap, so that's why you want to show. There are quite. This will happen at least 3 to 4 minutes, it will keep happening. You can see the amber color, it get faded out once the time progress. Means all the iron is getting over. There's no more iron.
Okay, just tell us when to start.
We have other modules.
So we can punching.
Yeah, punching.
Yeah.
Faster.
What will it do? We'll put our hands inside and it will go slowly. Now it's liquid. Let it go deeper, deeper, deeper till you reach the tray base.
But why is it kind of silty at the bottom?
Actually, this is not density mesh, so cornstarch particles are like 14 microns. So in this height profiles, they are a bit like sedimented.
So if I remove the sediment,
yeah, density mesh.
Yeah, then you would not be. Then the punching would not work.
It is there. It's just that you don't feel the thick layer at the bottom.
How do I know I'm not punching the sediment? I'm punching the sediment.
But you are punching on the top.
Okay.
Sorry.
That's okay. So
faster. No, but you're not punching the sediment. Sediment is settled at the bottom, right? But you are getting the impact from the top layer only.
That's what you're telling me, you shyster.
Okay. Okay. We are done
we'll
with you. Go.
We'll mix it. You keep your. Okay. So we'll
end of your quota.
Yes, I know. Done. Out.
Okay. Now by the way,
I'm going today.
Where? What do you mean you're going today?
For that.
Oh, right, you tell me how it is.
Yeah. Liquid. So,
yeah. It can be.
No,
it's
okay. Take well.
Out. If you rotate in one side,
the ink will be heavy.
Now the ink will be heavy. But if you rotate in the opposite side, in all previous position,
very conscious.
You can see the ink is there.
Oh.
But it
come back to it.
It will come back to it. But if you put ink in water.
Because they are more curious.
So, what is this liquid?
Glycerol.
And you tell me how it is. You tell me how
look,
it is.
Look, these things you can't take it out. But that thing you can easily take out.
Okay.
So this is because this is more viscous liquid than water.
Okay.
So this diffusion is less in glycerol and more in water. So in the same amount of time, this will diffuse less.
So why about your hands? You can try these props over here, vessel, and you might. If you want to experience, you can try it with hands.
How to use it for scientific?
But if you keep on doing that, then at a higher level, you can see the people.
then this is also the parts of constellation water, right? There are lots of particles over here.
This is,
once they start going through, when the force goes down, they start aggregating. So basically, right, the algorithm is just to show you that there are aggregates of this kind of particles. So because of this
hydroculture,
there will be
raindrops are in a spherical form, they are, why they are not continuous stream. So, and when you see this dew drops on the spider web, why they are in form of tiny droplets, not a cylindrical form. So if you take any fluid in cylindrical form, they are unstable because they have more surface area, and the fluid wants to minimize the surface area. So there are fluctuations, and you see that fluctuation which has which has wavelength 2 pi r. R is the radius of the initial cylinder. It grows faster than any other one. So eventually you end up with a tiny droplet with small this 2 pi r periodicity.
No, first mic. This is a world mic.
Cool.
Now, the question is, now whatever it is now giving out, that is the audio signals.
Yeah, it's going to be
essentially between 20,000 to 20,000.
Yeah, supposed to be.
Yeah.
Now, but then that is getting converted into radio, right?
So it's digital.
Yeah, it is digitized.
So it should be electromagnetic only. That is in the radio wavelengths.
No, no. The thing is, this guy has the responsor. So this is microphone. So when we speak, this will the corresponding frequency this converts. This converted frequency will be converted back with the analog to digital converter. Frequency is the same.
But it's not getting modulated.
No, it's the same frequency. It will not change it. This is one part. The another part is how much frequency we can hear. It's not that 20 to 20 kilohertz will completely hear.
No, it is the range that is here, but not necessarily that here too. Yeah. When probably we may not go even up to 15
kilohertz. Many will go up to 15 kilohertz. Some will go up to 17, but let us try now. We'll start with 20 hertz.
This is what ENT departments will have in...
This is only for kids to show.
Yeah, I understand. You don't know. No, but for a hearing purposes, you know. So that's what they'll have this kind of instrument and see up to what frequency and what pitch they can hear. Okay. So and then accordingly, they'll
design the instrument.
Now,
let us
see. Now, this is 30 hertz.
You have like awesome.
It's already up here. I don't think it's 50 hertz. Still, you may not be able to hear. Can you hear? Now, some buzzing noise is there.
Yeah.
Is 70, so this is go to 60, some may hear, some may not. 50, can you hear? I think it is not there. So 60, 70, 80, it's 90 now, it's 100, 900, 1K. Now we'll go in steps of 1K. So 2K, 3, sorry, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11.
Here itself already there is a drop.
Okay, don't believe this.
No, not this. Drop in the sense hearing.
Okay, yeah. Okay.
So that is from 8 to 9 kilohertz when you're going up. Already it is dropping.
Don't believe this graph here because that's a free software. It may not be proper.
Now you see here it has dropped.
10, 11, 12. Many will be almost stopping here.
Yeah.
13. I could hear some small. Okay. It stops for me over here. Yeah. Many may hear.
So this is 14K.
Shruti may be able to hear it.
Some humans may have this capability. It is not.
Sorry.
It's basically about the electronic filters, demonstration of filters. In your mobile phones, you have your transmitting frequency is going out, and incoming frequency is coming in to your mobile set, and then FM frequencies are also coming.
Yes, sure.
Listen. By the same. Oh. So here how do you discriminate between these two?
Yes,
so this is a time varying instantaneous signals. they are all in sinusoidal lineage. So now you can see that to purify the signal, it's not exactly the purify, it is discriminating the frequencies. So you have a water tap kind of thing, so that's the analogy of that. And then you can see exactly the same thing here, a filter, and then it is the noise is mixed with the signal, and then through the filter it is. So here the demonstration of all the types of filters. So we have basically a low pass filter, high pass filter, band pass and band stop. So low pass filter allows the all the sinusoidal signals up to certain cutoff frequency, afterwards it cuts it. So next is the high pass filter. It allows up to it allows above the certain cutoff frequencies, and the low frequencies are avoided. And here in the band pass filter, it is a range of frequencies are in the band stop. This is the basic thing demonstration. So here you can see the signal source, and then the frequency is swept from the this sweeping from the 10 megahertz to 180 megahertz. This is the 150 megahertz low pass filter. And you can see this yellow one is the one, the copy of it from the signal source, and then it's a power split, and then one copy is going to the filter, just to demonstrate. So the green one is the one which is the filtering action. See, after the 150 megahertz, you can see it is suppressed. You can just look at it, up to 150. So the signal is gone. So and also to stress upon, so this is the microstrip filter. At the lower frequencies, it's very difficult to design a filter in a microstrip base. It is the design in such a way that there are something called the carving thing. It's a tapered lines. Actually, this is something like 50 centimeters the filter, because the wavelength is 150 megahertz. So this is 40 centimeters filtering. So here you can see this constitutes from here to here, the complete thing is one inductor, and here it is one capacitor. So this constitutes a resonating frequency. So this is the ninth order filter. So where you have the resonating. So each resonating frequencies will suppress the thing, have resonating frequencies. So overall constitutes have a cutoff at the 150. And then we have a FM notch filter.
Yeah, here let me ask you a question. Okay. Now, how effectively you will be able to bring down the frequencies, that how sharply you will be able to bring
exactly
it down? So, for example, there is a tapering.
Yes.
So, if you want to bring it down almost vertical, what do you do?
You increase the number of arms, number of states. So each one stage corresponds to 20 dB per decade. So when you increase, it's almost 9th order means up to 180 dB per octave. So it is a huge cutoff. So when you want to make really a digital pulse, you need to increase the number.
Okay, here we are explaining how the sensors run and work and its applications, where and all you use the sensors. So in physical, we need to quantify each parameter, quantity, how much, suppose you say temperature, light, intensity, how much intensity. So we sense these quantities because of our sensors. So in empirical parameters, we use the sensors to sense that quantity.
Maybe the amount of polarity.
We have different types of sensors. So each one will sensitive to different parameters. This is for light, this is for sound waves, this is for magnetic, this is for IR. This is for temperature, this is for pressure. So if you give pressure to this, it will convert mechanical energy to electrical energy. Suppose here light is not there, so I block it. It will sense and give the light. These sensors are, it's most important for automatic systems. So sound wave. So if you have magnet, you have to measure the magnetic field. So it will sense the magnetic field. This is IR radiation, so when IR source is there, it will give this. So this is temperature sensor. So if you go certain temperature and more than that, it will sense it. So this is a pressure sensor which you use for weight measurements and all. This is piezoelectric sensor. So if you apply pressure on this, it will generate different voltages for different pressures.
or it is called how you know.
So what is happening is, it is allowing only horizontal ways, horizontal plane to come through. When you keep like this, you can see the light is coming through. But when it is kept like this, it is vertical. So that horizontal component is blocked. That is called polarization. So this is a horn. It's a transmitter. This is another horn. It's acting as a receiver. So a signal is passed to the transmitter. The transmitter radiates, and here the receiver receives the signal, and it is shown in the spectrum analyzer. It's a frequency versus horn. So when you connect it, the power goes down. When you block it, power goes down.
It's pointing towards you, no other color side is blue. So now I'll just turn this by one turn, blue again, and it's tangled up here. I'll do it again, this is two turns, it's even more tangled up. Now I'm not going to rotate this, I keep it as it is, but I'll just move the strings. You see that. It's
okay.
So first I untangled it. Okay. I'll show you
again
one more time.
Yeah.
One more time.
Yeah.
One more time. No rotation. Yeah. This is actually something very mathematical. It's basically topology. It has to do with the structure of rotations in three-dimensional space. So this is fixed. There's a plane which is fixed.
Right.
And this is a piece of this is a rigid body,
right,
which is being rotated. And I'm showing you that two turns of this body is actually, I can remove the two turns. I cannot remove it for one turn, but I can remove it for two turns.
I see.
This constrains all the particles in nature to have spin either half or it cannot be one turn. It has to be a fraction of either half or one or three over two. It has to have a fractional, I mean, it has to be something in a half or something or
either
half. So this actually gives rise to a classification of all the particles in nature into both.
Here you can make small small component only. And okay, so one more so the chair is that,
but we can take like 85, 80,
we can move here and there.
So now
because it's portable. Okay. Now
if
it is
you have a
everywhere.
Star over here,
but if you consider your mobile phone, now it's portable. So before that, it was a landline. Like so you can't program
now
that thing.
This is the distance to the star. And this we can measure from this to that. So it is roughly 3 meters.
Yeah.
Right. Now, h by x by 2 is equal to 10.
that's the equation. This is basically the perpendicular and this is the base. So perpendicular by base is equal to cantilever. Perpendicular by base is basically this is x, so this is x by 2, right? So now h is basically x by 2 into tan theta. H is basically the distance. So we have measured this thing, how much tan 82 degree, right? So tan of 82 degree. Into 1.5
aluminium of the head
would be 10.6 meters. So we have measured this distance, so it's roughly like 11 meters or so. So it's, so you don't have to go to the star to measure the distance. You can measure by this method. So this is called
one is brass, the other one is aluminium. And now I'm going to blow them down there, right? So which one will reach faster?
Yes, you can give it in.
Yeah, okay, you can feel it.
I think both are the same thing.
I think this is heavy, okay? So based on that, what do you expect?
What do you think?
This one, okay? I have no idea. I don't know. Okay,
we'll start.
See, they're moving pretty much the same rate, right?
Same, yeah.
So this is, how old are you, which standard are you? 8 standard. So I don't know, have you come across Galileo's experiments from you? So what is happening is that independent of the weight or the composition of the liquid, the both the solid cylinders are moving at the same rate. So this is basically saying that gravity imparts the same acceleration irrespective of mass or composition. So that's basically what it is. Now suppose I take this cylinder and this one. One is a thin one and one is a fat one.
The same?
Yeah, I don't know exactly if someone passed it. So, what do you expect? This one is the first?
What is it? That is heavier than this, huh?
No, this.
Same only?
This you can feel.
This is you're telling that size is different, but so again you will roll it, huh?
Yeah, so which one will go faster? So you said something, small.
Yeah. Same thing.
Okay. Again, they are moving at the same
bigger,
rate.
Same only. I thought that is bigger, but no, so that will go faster.
So they have gone at the same rate again. So again, it looks like that independent of the radius of the solid cylinder, they move at the same rate. So, well, think about it.
So this is just a box with a white paper inside and then other side black paper. Okay. And then we made two holes. Here we can adjust the hole size with an iris. When you do experiment, you don't need this. You just put a hole with standard size. Okay. Not make bigger or smaller, standard size. And through this you can see. And here if you see, you can see the clouds.
Oh wow!
Can you see the clouds? Seriously?
Yeah, I can see.
Okay,
remove the look. Can you see the sky? And then when I adjust it, what happens is the light will reduce, but the sharpness of the image will increase. Can you see?
I'm without specs, yeah. I can't.
This is focused image. Anybody with any eye
blurry.
Can
see.
You can also see.
It is blurry because it is very big.
Down, see now here, see.
Where? Yeah, I'm seeing there.
You can see cloud.
You know the center.
Yeah, I do see.
It's called iris imaging, right?
Pinhole.
Pinhole imaging.
I do see a change when you.
So this can be used for seeing solar eclipse also. It's safe to see. Without any, you don't need any filter. It's fully increased.
Okay.
Now I'm decreasing it.
Okay, okay. Is that the same?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a cloud.
And you can try one.
Yeah. So it can be, in fact, it should be possible to get a light.
For me, yes.
I mean, some purpose.
It's just purpose.
Yeah. No, no, I know.
So this is got an order from.
Yeah, next time we can actually.
So we get that.
So CNC machine, basically CNC machine.
Basically.
So all CNC machine has 3-axis movement, it has 5-axis speed.
What are those two? Other two?
Other two, suppose this is X, Y, Z. Suppose this is Z. X, Y, Z. Suppose
we
touch it. Now, if it is rotating, then it's 1-axis movement. I mean, red axis. 4-axis. If it's tilting, suppose it's tilting, that is 4-axis. So, like this, you can make this years also. Because suppose you are doing this operation, XYZ operation, XYZ operation, then for that, for how much direction you have to rotate it, right? So it will automatically.
Yeah, so now things are actually moving up. That's because they are polymer and the cross link is too much. So we are getting this sort of thing.
Hey, you are not
going
to get it. Yeah, but you are
going to get it.
So this is an incline. So if I put this here, instead of
going down the incline, which you normally expect something to be, it's going up. So what actually is happening, unlike the bottle, we just roll it down, it rolls down. So what happens is the center of mass of this object is along this axis, right? So basically, you can, because it's symmetric, you can consider it to be at the center, right? So if you look carefully, you see that this thing is actually going down. So if you draw a diagram here, how this thing is, what this is happening. So you have this very steep incline. So here is the big ball. So here is the center of mass. And this ball is going like this. So the center of mass is finally here. So actually the center of mass is going down. It does it follows the incline all right. But the center of mass, if you look closely down from there, you will see the center of mass is going down. Look at down. And then when this height will actually decrease when you go from here to here.
Yeah.
Yeah. So basically the center of mass is actually the
right? Say for example, if you take this rod and put current, make it oscillate like this, it has a direction, right? Correct. But look at this. This is metal, so now if you leave a electron over here, it can go any direction, right? It doesn't have any particular direction.
Right, but in order to measure.
So say for example, I put a wire over here, right? If it starts pulling out electrons, those electrons can
come from anywhere.
All the directions actually, right? So say for example, one radiation is coming, and that radiation, the wavelength, when it resonates with this structure, then it will induce a current. It's like a bead. It's like a bead of a ball. You are actually oscillating the whole thing. Right. So it doesn't matter you connect your wire here or from sideway. Okay. You will only measure the current. You will not be able to distinguish whether the current has a direction or not. It's a AC current with respect to. So think of this way, that electromagnetic field has an electric vector and the magnetic vector, right? So forget about the magnetic part. Electric vector.
Yeah, so this is an organization. You know why it's this? So there is, you see some angle, there's a shape, it's not a straight line, there is a shape here. Okay? When it falls, due to Bernoulli principle, wherever there's a bulge region, you will have a low pressure. Wherever there's a it can call it as concave region, it will have low high pressure. So the seed tends to go towards low pressure region. That's why it goes this way, and due to gravity, this is more mass and this is less mass. It tends to go forward and tries to spin, keep on spinning. It goes anti clockwise. Yeah. Yes.
And so coming on that, so why it does that is because it has a seed inside you, right here. This is what I've dissected and taken on. Yeah, it's actually, yeah, being heavy, it is there itself. So when it does that, it actually moves far away from the wind and it actually disperses the seed. So that's how nature uses this aerodynamics and uses the seed to disperse it far and populate the plant. That's what we were trying to tell you.
So this is the application. We can see another application is that you can see the solar eclipse. If you see with this, you can see the sun also. That will be like in case of solar eclipse, you can see without harming your homemade.